God out, we're going to do something for the kids. And they show up, don't they, Brother Burton? And every week, a good number, if not about half of those kids, they just walk to come to Super Church and get some candy and sing some songs and then get preached to and learn about Jesus. And I praise the Lord for that. I'm glad we had a part in it. Amen. We invested. You know, it's not just about, if you got some preachers here, look here at me, it's not just about your church. One of the best things we ever figured out around here is that it's okay for it to help somebody else's church and do nothing for ours. That's right. You say, do nothing. Well, really, it doesn't do nothing for ours, because God always give and it shall be given. He'll turn around and bless you for it. But you got to get to the place that it ain't about that. That God can use you to help others. All right, we're out of time for this morning. We'll give you a few minutes break between now and the morning service. Can you play something up there? Now listen, you better be careful about going to the bathroom and staying long, because there's people coming in that don't have a seat, and they may get yours. All right, so do the best you can. God bless you. We'll see you in about 5 minutes. We'll start with the choir. Turn it up a little more. Glory to God.
You from the trials that it seemed I faced.
How about that, Curtis? Go.
Wondering why God left me here to struggle. I thought of all the verses and the scriptures I had read. How he promised to.
Like Paul and Silas, John and Peter, fallen in the battle for the Lord. He took a stand for freedom when Jesus took the sword. And millions are in danger if they even speak his name.
But boldly they proclaim that we're the reason Jesus came.
We've got to tell the truth. Jesus saves. We cannot water down the word. There is no other way.
No hell may rise against us, though Satan steals the day.
We cannot bend.
We cannot break.
We've got to tell the truth. Jesus saves.
Miss Wendy Tinsley, are you in the building?
Miss Wendy Tinsley. We cannot water down the word.
Y'all see Wendy? Wendy Tinsley. Miss Wendy Tinsley. One more.
Go choir.
There's nothing like religion in the good old fashioned way. I'm walking in old time way, and I want the world to know that I'd rather be an old time Christian than anything I know. I'd rather be an old time Christian than anything I know.
If you're just coming in, we've had youth rally this weekend. That's what's going on. We've got a lot of visitors still with us this morning. We had a special Sunday school hour. So we obviously are starting a little bit later than normal, and we might go a little later than normal, but just relax. Let the Lord help you today.
Thank you. Caiaphas.
46.
Where's all the men?
Grab a hymn book. We're going to pray together, and then we're going to sing together. And so if you just go ahead and grab your book on your way up to the standing position, bow your heads. Miss Scott, you play for me if you would. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for how good you are to us, and we don't want to just say that because we often say it. Lord, even this morning we have seen again an example of your exceptional goodness in our lives. Lord, we praise you for it. We thank you for the grace of God that is sufficient. Lord, sufficient to give people victory and joy in the middle of circumstances that this world just can't understand. I praise you for that. I thank you, Lord, for the good times that you got us out of storms. Let us be on the mountaintop for a while, but we're thankful that even when it's low, you're making it good. We praise you for that. We do ask you to help us now in the rest of this service. We thank you for the souls that have been saved. We thank you, Lord, for the people that have gotten right, just heard a testimony, and the group that just left that Two of them got saved, and she said two that they have really been praying for got right with the Lord. Lord, we thank you for that. That's what we do it for. That's why we have the meeting. We praise you for doing your part. We thank you for your faithfulness. Now bless the rest of this service, Lord. There's still spiritual needs in here this morning that need to be met that only you can help with. So I pray you bless the choir as they sing again in just a minute. Be with the special singing and help Brother Charlie as he brings the message today. Use him. Help us, Lord, just to wait on you this morning and hear from heaven. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, what number, Brother Ken?
76.
All right, we appreciate you being with us. And if you're visiting locally, we certainly appreciate you being here today. And if you walked in, it's a little different than a typical Sunday because of our youth rally weekend. But we certainly thank you for being here. And if you're visiting locally and never visited before, these guys want to give you a visitor packet. If you visited with us and didn't get one, they'll just walk down the aisle. What number did you say?
176.
While we're turning to 176, just slip your hand up and let them give you one of those. We appreciate everybody being here. Let's sing it out good and loud.
Jesus, what a friend of sinners, Jesus, lover of my soul, sing out. Jesus, what a friend for sinners, Jesus, lover of my soul. Say.
stand while the choir's coming down and shake hands with somebody around you there. Move a little if you can. Praise God. I know it's been warm in here. We got the air running now. It'll cool off here in just a bit. Praise the Lord. You can be seated. Brother Ken, you come quick as you can, do these announcements. Just got one.
You talking about the bus thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, tell them to be careful.
All right. Appreciate you being in church this morning. Praise God for it. Listen to these announcements real quick.
All right. Let's go and have our ushers come forward because I only have one announcement, so it'll be quick. But it's very important. Listen, we have the bus kids out here tonight after the service, and they have the blow-up game, so the back exit will be closed. There'll be a lot of things going on out there, so please take your time getting out of the parking lot, and everybody will have to exit out here to East Court Street. And being that the parking lot is super full, please be patient and don't lay on the horn and rev your motor and lose all the religion and pull out your pistols.
Yeah.
None of that.
Hey, is that it?
Yeah.
Oh, don't pull out your pistols. That's my greatest fear, is not an outsider coming in and trying to hurt us. My greatest fear is somebody parked real close and their vehicle backfires and we all shoot each other in here. Because I know we got multitudes packing heat in here at all times. And they ain't like Barney. Y'all ain't got you one bullet in your pocket. Y'all fully loaded and daring somebody to shoot. So let's make sure it's a real bad guy. Here'll be a good sign. I will have slipped down behind this pulpit. I see a real bad guy, I'll go down here and be giving the signal. All right, so let's don't shoot each other. Brother Ken's exactly right. Praise the Lord. Let's pray for the offering. Now, if you're visiting today, both for the youth meeting or locally, we don't expect you to give. We're just thankful that you're here with us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all your goodness. We do praise you, Lord, for your love. We ask you to bless now the offering. Help it to be multiplied that we might use it to see more people saved than ever before. In Jesus' name, amen. Man, Razy family, if you want to come on over and get ready. And I've got the mics over there where you can stand by the piano. Charlie. With us this weekend, this is the Manorazzi family, or part of them. There's two more of them down there, and they're going to sing for us a couple songs this morning. I got to meet them, I guess it was about a few months ago at the Youth Ablaze, and actually mom and dad, at least, and the kids when they were very small, I reckon, maybe wasn't born yet, they used to come to New Manor, some of the meetings that we've had in the past, and we were glad to reunite, and we praise the Lord for it. And they sung for us over there. They're going to sing for us some this morning and again tonight, and it'll be a blessing to you. Let the Lord speak to you. Now, you know how it works. Even on Sunday morning, if the Lord touches your heart, you can just come to the altar right in the middle of singing or preaching or anything else. Don't bother us a bit. All right, y'all sing. God bless.
Told all you, but everything he told you is probably a lie. I've had people ask, so you guys travel a lot? And no, we don't. Our ministry is our church. And my dad started our church about 8 years ago, Heritage Bible Baptist Church. And I just wanted to say that this church has been a huge blessing to our family. About 8 months ago, we started our bus ministry, and this church was really instrumental. We've grown up with the New Manor CDs and just the New Manor, the bus route, the New Manor had always heard about it. And this morning, the first three boys I ever picked up, they live with their grandmother. Their grandmother died this morning, yeah. And I was just broken when I saw this choir get up. Mm-hmm. And just saw it. I could feel it. I could feel them. I knew, you know, just the bus ministry has been a big part of my life. And yeah. Last Wednesday night, we had four get saved, and that just really blessed my heart to see this group get up here. Man, it was real. And I just thank God for letting us be here. We don't think we're anything. The Bible says in John 3:30, he must increase, but I must decrease. Yeah. We're nothing. Amen. Nothing's going to get done with us. It's all the Lord. Amen. It's good to be saved. I'm glad God saved me. Got saved when I was 7 years old and been saved ever since. Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to try to sing for you. Some morning there will come no night, and I shall slip away and fly, soar above the starry blues with my Lord. Don't it make you wanna go? Pass beyond all toil and strife, no more pain or tears to wipe. I'll be safe in the arms of my Lord. Don't it make you wanna go?
Don't it make you wanna go to a land of peace? Don't it make you wanna go to a life so sweet? Get ready to go, get out of that crimson flow. Don't it make you wanna go?
I've got loved ones over there, some more than their presence again I'll share. We'll embrace a million years in that land. Yeah. Don't it make you wanna go? The deaf up there are gonna hear, the lame up there will walk with cheer, and blinded eyes will see as clear as the sun. Don't it make you wanna go?
Some folks have had more than their share of problems, and so many things they cannot understand. But they've been faithful through the years and walked on through the tears. They walked on holding to an unseen hand. And one of these days,
we're going home with Jesus. One of these days,
one of these days,
one of these days, we're going home with Jesus. One of these days,
the sun will rise just as it did this morning, and it will seem to be as any other day. But then a shout will ring out without a warning, and the children of the Lord are gonna fly away.
Don't it make you wanna go to a land of peace? Don't it make you wanna go to a life so sweet? Get ready to go, get under that crimson flow. Don't it make you wanna go?
get ready to go, get on that crimson flow, don't it make you wanna go?
Hey, I'm glad my God's not dead. You know, Buddha, they're all still in the grave. All those guys are still in the grave. I talked to the Lord. He talked to me this morning. He's real. Hey, that stone is rolled away. That stone's not there anymore. He's not there. He's alive. Thank God for the power of Jesus. He saved me. He can save you in here if you're not saved this morning. He's been good. He's been good. You can get something this morning. He's here.
When man sinned in the garden, that sin Jehovah could not condone, and the blood shed by animals could not forever my sin atone. But the Son had compassion, and he said, Father, I'll be your lamb. And once again, blood was shed as the soldiers nailed his hands. It's been 3 days since heaven watched their Prince of Glory die. His followers stand round in mourning, for in the tomb their Savior lies. But at the grave, something's happening. As it screams, I've lost my hope. Angels rise in anticipation, for the strong is coming home. And there he comes, and he's got the blood that he shed on Calvary. And the Father said, well done, my son. This is the last blood I'll ever need. And there he comes, and he's got the blood that he shed on Calvary. And the Father said, well done, my son. This is the last blood I'll ever
need. Sorry, we don't know what we're doing.
Yeah, we really don't. This song we're going to sing is kind of a participation song. You'll get the hang of it when we start singing it. But just looking back over the years, all the things that the Lord's done, I'm sure you have them in your life too. You look back and you don't know, realize why you go through something. And then you look back 10 years later and say, oh, well, that fell into place. I didn't even realize that. The Lord's got it all under control. And at the end of the day, all you really can say is amen. The Lord's been good. You don't understand it, but he knows what he's doing. I don't know what you're going through today, but the Lord knows what he's doing. If you're on the mountain, in the valley, he knows what he's doing. He's been good. Amen.
We're all on a journey, and we're called to walk by faith. There will always be the mountains and valleys in our way. But right here in this moment, may our strength be renewed as we recall what God has done and how we've seen him move. His
there anybody here who's found and faithful? Anybody here who knows he's able?
Say amen.
Is there anybody here who's seen his power? Anybody here walk through the fire?
Say amen.
Anybody here found joy in the midst of sorrow? Peace in the storm, hope for tomorrow.
And you've seen it time and time again. Just say amen. Sometimes through the darkness, it gets hard to see. But be bold and courageous and follow where he leads.
Greater is the one who's in us than he who is in the world. So child of God, remember the battle is the Lord's.
Is there anybody here who's found it faithful? Anybody here who knows he's able? Say amen. Is there anybody here who's seen his power? Anybody here walk through the fire? Say amen. Anybody here found joy in the midst of sorrow? Peace in the storm, hope for tomorrow.
And you've seen it time and time again.
Just say
to mention. Some of you may not know if you weren't at the youth rally. Mackenzie, raise your hand. She doesn't like this, but too bad. She has cancer, and real bad. And, you know, sometimes we come in on Sunday morning, we think, wow, I'm having it rough today. I didn't have my coffee. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Oh, man. Really burdened. I didn't have time to get my breakfast. I'm going to have, well, we may be late to the restaurant. Oh, let me just say this morning, you and I have nothing to complain about. God's been good in our lives. And if the sister can sing while she's full of cancer, we can just go ahead and thank God today for the blessings in our life. I appreciate this family. They're from Delaware. So we have Northeast singing today. We have Northeast preaching, if I even get to preach today. But we didn't tell you that beforehand because they're Yankees. I'm afraid some of you wouldn't like them. And no, I'm only kidding. But they're from Delaware. And I appreciate the Manorese family. And they sang this song. And I'm just going to ask them to sing it one more time here and then preach just a little bit. But I appreciate God and the fact that we don't serve a dead God.
Yep.
We don't. Our God's not sick. Our God doesn't have a headache. Our God has all might and all power and all strength. There's no one like our God. And we ought to just glory in God this morning. I'm glad that we get to be in church. We don't have to be in church. We get to be in church. Isn't it good to be in church? God's been good. Turn to the person next to you. Give them one reason why you can say God's been good to you. Tell them right now. Give them a reason. Tell them a reason why God's been good. Come on now. We ought to just get used to talking. Some of you aren't telling the person next to you. Come on, think of one reason, at least one. Turn to the person next to you and say, God's been good because... Now, if you're a married man and you're smart, you said, honey, God's been good because he gave me you as my wife. If you're a smart man, you just did that. Listen to this song. Some of you may not know it, a bunch of you will. But let the Lord minister to your heart.
Charlie, come here.
You've got to sing it with
you
us.
You've got to sing it with us.
You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You are God alone from before time began. You are on your throne and you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne and you are God alone.
You're the only God whose power none can contend. You're the only God whose name and praise will never end. You're the only God who's worthy of everything we can give. You are God, that's just the way it is.
You are God alone from before time began. You are on your throne and you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne and you are God alone.
You're
unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable, you're unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. You are God alone from before time began. You are on your throne and you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne and you are God alone. You're unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable. You are God alone.
Amen. Go ahead and take your Bible. Look at Psalm chapter 86, if you would. Psalm chapter 86 in the Word of God. I appreciate the Manarese family, and they're a great blessing. You pray for their family, that God would bless them, bless their church. You pray for this mom and dad. You can imagine if your daughter was going to the hospital on a daily, near daily basis, taking chemo treatments. Mackenzie's on a 2.5-year plan for treatment, and pray that God would just give her healing. I appreciate all the groups that have stayed over from all the different states, all those that have stayed over for youth rally, from youth rally. Appreciate you being here. And it's good to be back at New Manna Baptist Church. I can't believe time's flying. This is my 12th year in a row
being here, and it's just time's flying by. And that means Preacher Tony's getting old, and but anyway, sure. But it's good to be here. I say this every year, I'm going to say it again today. Don't take your church for granted. You're not spoiled if you have a lot. You're spoiled if you have a lot and you don't appreciate it. So don't get spoiled. I don't know if you know this or not, but the way y'all have church, it's not happening like this everywhere. Now, obviously, we know it's not about you. It's all about God. But the fact that you get to come to a church that still believes in worshiping and praising God, and I don't mean just working something up, and I'm talking about in a way that matches the Bible, it is a great blessing for you to be part of the New Manor Baptist Church. And I appreciate people that are just faithful. Well, Josh over there on the bass, Miss Scott and piano, they've been doing that ever since I've come. And I thank God for people that just... I'm glad my girls, my wife and girls, y'all stand up real quick. I'll make them stand up. And they were young when we first started coming. My wife, Jennifer, she's still young. And then Vanessa next to her is 18 now. She would have been 6. And Christiana's 22. She would have been 10. And Melinda's 15. She would have been 3. And it's just, you know, it's good to have friends. And it's good to be able to come to a church where there's friends. They still love New Jersey people. Now, I haven't gotten shot by any of those pistols yet. And we're not allowed to carry those in New Jersey. So we're Yankee people, be nice to us. But I'm glad that we serve the same God. And I'm glad we're all going to spend eternity in heaven together. Amen. And that's a great thing. Psalm chapter 86 in the Bible. It is 11:57. Now, I'm just saying that so you know that I know what time that it is. The kids went up for carnival and whatever, and some of you as bus workers may have to slip out at whatever point. I'm not going to preach all day, so don't get too nervous about it. I'm not known for short messages, although last night I preached for 4 minutes or something like that. And don't get your hopes up, all right? It's not going for 4 today, but I do want to look into the Bible. How many of you are glad that you have a Bible? Would you raise it up in the air and say amen right there? Hold your Bible up if you have one. Thank God for the Bible. Now, some of you are holding up your cell phone because you got your Bible on your cell phone or something like that. But I'm glad that this is a Bible-believing church. I'm talking about a church that believes that God gave His Word by inspiration and God has kept His Word by preservation. I thank God that the King James Bible is the inspired, perfectly preserved Word of God without mistake or error. Are y'all with me? Thank God that we've got the book. And thank God that He's shown us the truth about that. And again, I appreciate the opportunity to be here. We had a good time with Youth Rally. Thank you, church, for all of your work. Thank you for all of your money put into it. Thank you for your prayer especially. And we mean that, and all the groups that are here from the other churches, we appreciate the opportunity to come and to be part of Youth Rally. And I'm so thankful for all that God did, and we are glad to be here today. Psalm chapter 86, if you're looking on your Bible, it may say right under Psalm 86, a prayer of David. A prayer of David. And I want to look at some things here and notice with me. I'll begin it in verse 10. For thou art great and doest wondrous things. Notice this statement. Thou art God alone. We just sang about that. Thou art God alone. There's only one true God, and that's Jehovah God. That's the God of the Bible. And you ought to thank God if God in His grace and mercy has showed you the truth that there's only one God. If you were born in India, there's a good chance you would have followed after Hinduism and believed in a plurality of God, polytheism, the idea of thousands of gods. If you had been born and following Buddhism, you would be praying to Buddha. If you had been born and in a Muslim country, you would have been praying to Allah. Many of you maybe have been raised around Catholicism. If you're from the Northeast especially, that's where things are in the Northeast. A lot of people going to Catholic Church, and you'd pray to a statue of Mary. But let me remind everybody this morning, all of those other small g gods are false gods. There's only one God that's true, and it's the God of the Bible. Thou art God alone. Thank God we serve the true God. Notice verse 11, David's heart, And remember, it's a prayer to God. Teach me thy way, O Lord. I will walk in thy truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart. And I will glorify thy name forevermore. For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest hell. I'm going to pray. Could you ask God while I'm praying to help you to push everything else out of your mind right now except God's word? How many of you believe the verse where it says God's exalted his word above his name? How many of you understand this is the Bible? And let's give it proper respect this morning. And obviously, I know everybody, we're sitting here and we're in the church auditorium. But let's make sure we're not just here in body. Let's worship God in spirit and in truth. And let's give our proper attention to the Bible this morning. And let's have God's word speak to our hearts. I need something from the Bible this morning. And you need something from the Bible. And I'm glad we have the Bible. So let's pray and ask God to talk to us in our hearts. Father, I pray this will be a profitable time. And Lord, I pray for the junior churches going on. I pray you be with them. Help Brother Burton as he'll preach. I pray that you move in our hearts right now and give us something from the Scripture that be a help and a blessing. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Notice verse 11. Teach me thy way, O Lord. Let me ask you a question. Do you still have a teachable spirit? You know what the old saying is? It's hard to teach an old dog what? New tricks. It's hard to teach an old dog new tricks. The longer you're saved, the more teachable you should become. We ought to have a heart that's like David. He's praying to God and he says, teach me thy way, O Lord. It's sad in America today that a lot of people that call themselves Christians know more about what's going on in television than they do the Bible. More than what's going on in Hollywood than we do the Word of God. God doesn't want us to be ignorant of His Word. God says, study to show thyself approved unto God. Notice the next two words, a workman. Not a playman, but a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Every one of us ought to come to church this morning hungry, hungry for the word of God. We need to pray like David and say, Lord, teach me thy way. Teach me thy way. We ought to want to learn the word of God. And then notice David's statement here. Teach me thy way, O Lord, and his determination, I will walk in thy truth. Would you say that together out loud? Ready? I will walk in thy truth. David didn't say, I might walk in thy truth. David said, I will walk in thy truth. Church, David was determined to obey the word of God. And that's a great determination to obey the word of God. David did not want to be an inconsistent Christian. The young people were having a theme for the youth rally, more than trending. And the idea is, instead of being up and down or just on their Christian life for a little while, our goal is for them to learn spiritual maturity. And all of you teenagers here today, that is possible, but you're never going to be consistent for God unless you determine, like David, I will walk in thy truth. It doesn't matter if your friends are walking in God's truth. It doesn't matter if the world's walking in God's truth or not. You need to make it personal. I will walk in thy truth. We ought to all want to walk in the truth of the Word of God. Obeying the Word of God is a choice that anyone can make. Now, continue along with me in verse 11. Teach me thy way, O Lord. This is David's prayer. This is David's heartbeat. We see David's determination. I will walk in thy truth. Now, how could David know that he was going to walk in God's truth? How did David think that it might be possible for him to walk in God's truth? What was David's passion that he would be allowed by God to walk in God's truth? Notice the next part of his prayer. And if it's your habit to mark or underline in your Bible, I want you to notice the next three words in particular. David's prayer. David said, unite my heart. Would you say those three words? Ready? Unite my heart. Notice what he wanted from God. Unite my heart to fear thy name. Notice again the word unite my heart. That word unite, it's the only time found in God's word. And it's right here in Psalm 86 and verse 11. Unite my heart to fear thy name. Unite means to unify. Unite means to make as one. If it's your habit to mark and underline in your Bible or put notes there, would you mark that? Unite means to unify. Talk to me, church. Unite means to what? Unify. One more time, what's it mean? Unified. It means to make as one. Now, if you're still thinking, if you're still with me, here's what David's prayer is. David is speaking to his God. And David said, God, I want you to teach me. God, I want to be somebody that obeys your word. I will walk in thy truth. And here's his prayer request to God. David says, God, unite my heart to fear thy name. Here's what he's praying. God, I want you to give me a heart that is unified. I want you to give me a heart that is as one. I want you to give me a heart, God, that is solely for you. David did not want to have a heart that was all over the place, all over the map. David wanted to have a heart that was united for God. He wanted to have a heart that was as one for God. David was a man after God's heart because David had a united heart. David had this strong desire. Let me ask you a question this morning. Do you have a heart that is united for God? Do you have a heart that is one for God? Do you have a heart that is solely for God? Do you have a heart that is unified for God? Is your heart this way like David's heart was? Do you want to have a heart for God that is totally for God? Do you want to have a heart that is fully for God? Do you want to have a heart that is solely and single about God? Now listen, and we're laying a foundation. We're going somewhere. Stay with me if you would, please. If you don't have a united heart, then what you have is a divided heart. Keep your marker in Psalm 86 because we'll come back there. And go to the book of Hosea, if you would, please. Hosea chapter 10. Hosea and chapter 10. Notice if you would. And let's not be lazy in church this morning. Let's make sure that we turn to where we're going. If you don't have a Bible or if you're not used to turning, you can just listen. But Hosea chapter 10, and he's speaking about Israel. Notice verse 1. Israel is an empty vine. He bringeth forth fruit unto himself. According to the multitude of his fruit, he hath increased the altars. According to the goodness of his land, they have made goodly images. Notice verse 2, and if you're there, would you read it together with me out loud? Ready? Their heart is divided. Notice that statement. Their heart is divided. God's not happy with Israel in this chapter. Israel in verse 1 is an empty vine. There's no fruitfulness in Israel. Why? Their heart is divided. Now, notice that next statement in verse 2. Now shall they be found faulty. Faulty. Now, if I had you go to the doctor and you had a heart exam and they said, listen, you have a problem with your heart. Your heart is faulty. It's sad sometimes when people have a bad heart. We have a pastor in Pennsylvania, and just a few months back, his wife died from a heart issue. She was born with a heart that had problems, and they worked on her heart when she was very young. At a certain point, she had a heart transplant, and they had given her that new heart, and it lasted for a while, but her heart failed. Her heart was faulty. Now, if I told you that you had a heart problem, physically speaking, you'd be very concerned about that. If your heart started to create an issue for you right now, you'd say, hey, somebody dial 911. My heart isn't right. Something's wrong with my heart. How many of you would agree, since we're concerned about our physical heart having a problem, we probably ought to be concerned if our spiritual heart has a problem? It is a heart problem if you have a divided heart. God does not want you to have a divided heart. God wants you to have a united heart. God wants you to have a heart that is as one for Him. God wants you to have a unified heart for Him. God wants you to have a heart that is solely for Him. But Israel had a divided heart. A divided heart is a heart that's faulty. A divided heart is a heart that is not united to fear God's name. A divided heart has affections for things that God does not like. A divided heart has affections for things that are not God's will. A divided heart has an affection for things that are less than God's best. A divided heart has affections for things that distract you from God. A divided heart has affections for things that will hinder your walk with God. God wants you to be like David. God wants you to have it in your heart to have a united heart for Him. And if you don't have a united heart, then you have a divided heart. Let me say it to you this way. If you don't have a united heart for God, then what you have is a divided heart. And if you have a divided heart, what you have is a double heart. Look in Psalm chapter 12. Psalm chapter 12. If you still love Jesus, say amen. Amen. Psalm chapter 12. It's good to be in church this morning. Psalm chapter 12. Most of us in just a few minutes are getting ready to put a bunch of food in our stomach. But let me say this, what Jesus said, man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And we still need the Bible the day after youth rally. Psalm chapter 12. Anytime we open up the scripture, the Holy Spirit's trying to teach us something. Psalm chapter 12. And aren't you glad for the sweet Holy Spirit of God that can teach us things from His book? Psalm chapter 12, notice verse 1, please. Help, Lord. Come on, how many of you need that right there? I needed help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth. That's some of you single young women here in the church, right? Help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. So we got a problem here. The godly man ceaseth, the faithful are failing. They speak vanity, everyone with his neighbor. Their talk is just empty. It's vain. It's not really meaning anything. With flattering lips and with a double heart, do they speak? A double heart. A divided heart. Both of those are heart problems. You say, Brother Charlie, for the Christian, what's it mean to have a double heart? It means when you have two hearts, it means this. You're trying to have one heart for God and one heart for the world. You remember the scripture, I won't go there because of time. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15. If you know it, would you quote it? Love not the world. Let's say that again. Ready? Love not the world. Say it like you mean it this time. Ready? Love not the world. Tell the person next to you. Ready? Love not the world. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, talk to me, church, the love of the Father is not in him. Don't you think it's a problem in God's eyes if He looks down and He sees that you and I have a double heart? We come to the church house and we show our heart for God, but outside of the church house, if we're showing a heart for the world, that doesn't please God. God doesn't want us to have a double heart. God doesn't want us to have a divided heart. God wants us to have a united heart for Him. God wants you to have a heart that is single for Him. God wants you to have a heart that is solely about Him. God wants you to have a heart that is united for Him. That's what God wants. See, if you have a double heart, you're going to have a problem. If you're loving the world and trying to love God at the same time, that's not going to work. You say, why? We'll go to James chapter 1 real quickly, if you would. I'm preaching quick. I hope you'll listen quick. James chapter 1. It's good to be in church. You say, you keep saying that. Yeah, I want to remind you. It's good to be in church. James chapter 1. I'm glad I'm not in the mosque this morning. James chapter, come on now. Well, I'd never do that. You would have done that if it hadn't been for the grace of God. We get to be in our Bible-believing church and to open up the Scripture. What a blessing. James chapter 1 and verse 8. Together out loud if you're there. Ready? A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Listen, if you have a divided heart, you're going to have a double heart. And if you have a double heart, here's what you have. You have a double mind. And the Bible says that a double-minded man is unstable in all, not some of, but in all his ways. We could say this, a double-minded man, a double-hearted man, young people that are here left over from youth rally, that's somebody that's a trending Christian. Are you with me? Here's what it is. They come to youth rally, and they get their heart stirred in the moment. They have the heart somewhat united for God, but then you go home and you get off the bus or you get off the van and you go back to your bedroom or you go off to your school tomorrow, and all of a sudden you're around some of those other influences. May I suggest this is not time for you to have double-minded, double heart, divided heart. This is time for you to have a united heart. You need to be all in for God. Single, solely, unified. I love my God, and I am purposed not to be a trending teenager. I'm going to be a teenager that has a heart for God. Some of you know Amos chapter 3 and verse 3. Can two walk together except they be agreed? The answer is no. Listen, if we're going one way for God, we're not going to be on the same way as the world is. If we're going one way for God, we're not going to be on the same path as the carnal Christian. And I want to encourage every Christian in this room this morning, let's not love the world. Let's not try to be like the world. Let's just go ahead and say, I, by the grace of God, am a Christian, and I love God with a united heart. I'm serving God with a united heart. I'm not going to have a divided heart. I'm not going to have a double heart. I'm not going to have a double mind. I'm not trying to walk two different paths. I'm on the path for God by God's grace and with God's help. In Matthew chapter 6 and verses 22 through 24, here's what Jesus said. No man can serve two masters. No man can serve two masters. If you're saved, no longer is your father the devil. So then we need to get away from the devil, and we need to get away from the devil's crowd, and we need to be all in for God. Now the devil's going to try to mess with you. He's going to try to mess up your head. He's going to try to mess up your heart. You need to make sure that you keep your eyes on the Lord and don't get messed up. Don't do that. I don't have time to go where I was going to go, so let me jump around a little bit. Go ahead and look in the book of Romans. Let's go ahead and go there. I'm going to skip some things, and we're just going to jump right ahead. The book of Romans. And go to Psalms. It's close to Romans. Chapter 73. And I'm jumping around here. But let's look Psalm 73. David's prayer was, unite my heart. David had a friend named Asaph. And if you look at Psalm chapter 73, you're picking it up there, and it's about Asaph. Now, Asaph was a good man. Keep your marker, and again, I'm jumping all over. Y'all still with me? Were you okay? Keep your marker at Psalm 73, and look quickly at 1 Chronicles chapter 15. We're going to tie this together. 1 Chronicles chapter 15. And I want you to notice, this was Asaph. Asaph was David's friend. And 1 Chronicles chapter 15, pick it up in verse 15. And the children of the Levites bear the ark of God upon their shoulders with the staves thereon, as Moses commanded according to the word of the Lord. And David spake to the chief of the Levites to appoint their brethren to be singers with instruments of music, psalteries and harps and cymbals, sounding by lifting up the voice with joy. So David here is putting together his orchestra, and David's putting together his choir, And notice verse 17. So the Levites appointed Heman, the son of Joel, and of his brethren, what's that next word? Asaph. Okay, so we see here Asaph was a man that was part of David's music team. David was a man that loved to praise God, and so he appointed Asaph. Look in chapter 16. We'll pick it up in verse 4. If you're not in your Bible, you're going to miss it, so go ahead and look with me. 1 Chronicles 16 and verse 4. And he appointed certain of the Levites to minister before the ark of the Lord and to record, and notice, and to thank and praise the Lord God of Israel. Notice verse 5. Asaph, what's the next two words? The chief. So Asaph here, he's David's friend. He's part of David's praise. In fact, he is the chief with it. That's pretty important. And it goes through and lists some others in the verse, but notice the end of verse 5. But Asaph made a sound with cymbals. So Asaph was the cymbal player. Come on, how many of you think if you had an orchestra up here with cymbals, you'd be the cymbal player? Anybody out there like to bang those cymbals? I think Brother Burton would make a good cymbal player. He's preaching junior church, but he's that type guy. And Asaph was this man that had a heart for the Lord. He had a heart for the music, and he had a heart for the orchestra, and he had a heart for the songs, and he was a cymbal player. Look in 2 Chronicles chapter 29. We're going to fast forward to Hezekiah, about 250 plus years later and about 13 kings later. And look at 2 Chronicles chapter 29 and verse 30, what they were doing. This is a long time after Asaph. Verse 30, moreover, Hezekiah the king and the princes commanded the Levites to sing praise unto the Lord with the words of David, notice, and of Asaph the seer. So they're singing Asaph's song. Asaph wrote Psalm 50, and he also wrote Psalm 73 through 83. And here it is, over 250 years later, they're singing Asaph's song. And notice what the Bible says in verse 30, Asaph the seer, S-E-E-R. You say, what's that mean? It means this, Asaph was also a preacher, what we call a prophet, a seer. So let me ask you a question. Since we know Asaph was David's friend, and we know Asaph was a songwriter, and Asaph was a psalm writer, and Asaph played the cymbals for God, and Asaph was a seer, a preacher, or a prophet, how many of you would agree Asaph was a good man? Yes or no? Asaph's a good guy, right? Now, flip back quickly, Psalm 73, and I'm going as quick as I can. Stay with me, Psalm 73. I want you to notice Asaph in Psalm 73. Truly, God is good to Israel. And God's good to new manna. You sang about it. God's been good in my life, even to such as are of a clean heart. So we see Asaph knowing that God's been good. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. You say, well, how could this happen to a man like Asaph? How could he get to this place where he was on slippery ground? Notice verse 3. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Asaph, listen, church, he started looking out the window from the church house, and he started to see the world's crowd, and he makes this statement, I was envious at the foolish. For there were no bands in their death. They weren't in handcuffs. It didn't look like it was too bad for them. But their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men. Neither are they plagued like other men. Asaph saying, listen, it seems as if all is good with the wicked. Therefore, pride compasseth them about as a chain. Like you'd wear a necklace, that the pride, they just put it out there for all to see. Violence covereth them as a garment. They just put it on like clothes. And their eyes stand out with fatness. Fatness in the Bible is always spoken of as a good thing. And some of you ought to say amen right there. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. Who is this? This is the man of God. But he's come to a point where he's examining the wicked, and he actually has some envy in his heart because it seems like they're really doing well. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters of her full cup are wrung out to them. Basically, he said they run around saying whatever they want, doing whatever they want, and they just try to like pour it down the throats of the righteous. Hey, you're going to take it. Verse 11, and they say, how does God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increased in riches. He's watching them. He's looking at them. And then he says this, verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. Now again, if you're still with me, here's what he's saying. I'm watching the wicked, and it seems like everything's going well for them. And here it is, they even speak against God, but they're still seemingly prospering. But here it is, verse 13, I have cleansed my heart in vain. Notice my heart. I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. Asaph's coming to a point of saying, you know, I don't think it's really worth it to live for God. David, right, Asaph right now, his heart is divided. Right now, his heart is double. Right now, his mind is a double mind. But notice verse 15. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children. Here's what Asaph's saying. If I speak out loud what it is that I'm thinking right now, I'm going to offend my family. I'm going to offend my church family. If I tell people right now, because I'm here in church and I even serve in the church, or I'm in the youth department, and here it is, I'm on board. I sang in the choir this morning. And here it is, Asaph, a cymbal player for God, a prophet for God, a seer, a preacher, a psalmist, a songwriter, David's own friend. And he's taken a time to look at the wicked, and he's envying them, and he says, listen, if I speak what I'm thinking, I'm really going to hurt some people. Notice what he said in verse 16. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. This is hurting my head. I am so messed up right now. Notice verse 17. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end. Asaph said, listen, I was looking at the wicked, and I had envy in my heart, and my heart was messed up until I got to the church. And when I got there, then understood I their end. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou castest them down into destruction. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment, they are utterly consumed with terrors. As a dream when one awaketh, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. Here's what he's saying. You know what? I got it wrong. I thought the wicked were really doing well, but what I'm realizing is just a little time until God changes that whole thing around. Notice verse 21. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked. Notice, I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. Asaph saying, I cannot believe I got to the point where I started to think so poorly about my God and so well about the wicked. Nevertheless, I am continually with me. Stay with me, church. I'm on the home stretch. Thou hast holden me by my right hand. Here's what Asaph's saying. Although my mind got wrong, and although I've gotten my heart wrong, notice verse 23, God never let go of me through the whole journey. I am continually with me. Thou hast holden me by my right hand. Hey, my mind wasn't right, and my heart wasn't right, but God never let go of my hand through that whole experience. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel. Hey, here's the counsel, the word of God. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee? Hey, the world is not the place for the Christian. There is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. Notice his heart becomes united for God. There is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God, church, would you please look at that? God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart. Hey, you're here today, and you've been looking out the window. You may be a teenager, and you're in church every service, or you may be an adult, and you're in church on a regular basis. And although it looks like you're here in heart, really in your heart, you've been considering the wicked. You've been thinking about how out there in the world they seem like they're having a good time, seems like they're having a party time. All the bright lights have looked a little bit attractive recently. Hey, let me tell you something. All of the devil's apples have worms in them. He is a liar, and there's nothing out there in the world. You say, but I've been looking out there, and it seems like I'm plagued, and it seems like I've got problems, and it seems like they're doing well. Hey, that's a lie from the devil. You may have problems. You may have burdens, but thank God, God has got hold of your hand. God is not going to let go of you, and thank God you're still in the sanctuary. This morning, you need to look up to heaven and say, God, I want you to strengthen my heart. God, I want you to unite my heart. God, I want you to make my heart single and solely all about you. God, I don't want the world. I don't want the flesh. I don't want all the junk that's out there. God, I want to have a heart that's all about you. Psalm 86, and we'll close. Psalm chapter 86. It's 12:31. No sarcasm. I just want you to know I did not lose my clock up here. Psalm chapter 86. Notice verse 11. Can we close it out by just looking at this verse? Teach me thy way, O Lord. I will walk in thy truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. Now don't lose me in these next few minutes. We're almost home. Don't lose me. Why is it so important for you as a Christian, living in 2015, to have a heart that is united for God? Very simply from verse 11, please notice, teach me thy way, O Lord, I will walk in thy truth. In order for you to obey God, you have to have a united heart. You're not going to obey the truth of God with a double heart. You're not going to obey the truth of God with a double mind. You're not going to obey the truth of God with a divided heart. In order for you to be like David and say, I will walk in thy truth, you have to have a united heart. Your Christianity is going to be up and down unless you have a united heart where you're obeying God's word. Secondly, not only that, the reason why it's important for you to have a united heart is so that you will fear God. Notice verse 11, unite my heart to fear thy name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord brings about all types of blessings in your life. By humility and the fear of the Lord are riches and honor and life. Proverbs 22 and verse 4. In the fear of the Lord is strong confidence. Proverbs 14:26. The fear of the Lord prolongeth days. Proverbs 10:27. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs 1:7. If you don't have a heart that's united for God, you're never going to fear God's name properly. And if you don't fear, reverence, and respect, and love your God, and have an actual fear that if you step out of line, He's going to chasten you. If you don't fear God properly, you can't please God properly. The third thing, and notice this. The third thing, why is it so important for you to have a heart that's united for God? Verse 12, notice, I will praise thee, O Lord God, my God. Talk to me, church. How? With all my heart. In order for you to praise God properly, you have to have a heart that is united for God. You know why some people this weekend have been praising God and you haven't been? I'm not here to beat you up. Didn't come all the way from New Jersey just to yell at you in church this morning. But the reason why some of you have lost your shout, the reason why some of you don't have praise, is because you cannot praise God when you're double-minded. You can't praise God when you're double-hearted. You can't praise, not properly. You can't praise God properly with a divided heart. And David was praying because David loved to praise God. He said, God, unite my heart to fear thy name. I will praise thee, O Lord my God. Notice, with all my heart, and I will glorify thy name forevermore. Now here's one thing that'll help you to get your praise back. Notice verse 13. For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest hell. Let me tell you what ought to make you shout this morning. Let me tell you what ought to help put your praise back where it should be. If you really think about the fact that God has delivered your soul from the lowest hell. I know we're late for lunch. Come on. I know we're in church a little bit longer than normal this morning. But just think about it. You're not going to hell if you've been saved, if you've been born again. And one reason why you ought to be motivated to have a heart that is united for God is because your God is worthy of united heart praise. Not double heart, not double mind, not a divided heart. Your God is worthy of the best praise. David said in Psalm 138:1, I will praise. Praise is comely. That means it's appropriate. God inhabits praise. That means where you're praising, God moves into that place. I don't want to be somebody that serves God with a double heart. I don't want to serve God with a divided heart. I don't want to serve God with a double mind. Old Asaph, a friend of David's, he had a rough time where he kind of got off track and started looking at the world. But listen, thank God he still was in the sanctuary. And although he thought this would be a bad thing for my friends if I start speaking what I'm thinking, and it made his head hurt, finally he came to realize God had never let go of his hand. If you're here this morning with a divided double heart and a double mind, you ought to come to God this morning and pray just like David did. God, unite my heart. God, don't let it be all over the place. Let it be single and solely and all about you. If you're a teenager and you were here for youth rally, young person, if you're going to go home and not trend, if you're going to go home and stay on track, you can't have your heart all over the map. You can't have a double and a divided heart. For some of you, to have a heart that's united for God, you're going to have to go home, maybe separate from some friends you've had. You could be sitting next to a girl or guy right now that you like and they're not the right one. Sometimes you got to pick God over a friend. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your own personal Lord and Savior, and you walked into this church today, you might wonder, what are those people so excited about? I think I'm in church with a bunch of crazy people. They've been screaming and hollering and making all that noise. What are they shouting about? Well, let me tell you what we're shouting about. If we die today, we're going to heaven. It's not because we're good. It's not because we're a church member. It's not because we've been baptized. It's not because we're a member of New Man of Baptist. Listen, the reason why I know I'm going to heaven is because Jesus Christ died for my sins. And as an 8-year-old boy, I put my faith and my trust in Christ. And if you've never done that, you could do it today. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Who could say, Brother Charlie, I know I'm saved. Here's my hand. Raise it real high. You know you're saved. Thank God. You may put it down. Is there anyone here today you'd say, I don't know for sure if I were to die that I'd go straight to heaven? I'm concerned.